So without further ado, I would like to introduce, to call somebody who's going to be introducing our keynote speaker. Honorable Dan Oliver, he has been there from day one when we started this organization, seeking his advice, looking at where we merge. Honorable Dan Oliver is the first Canadian African, if I could go straight, black African, to be nominated to the Senate. He's a barrister, professor, entrepreneur, statesman, advocate, and in all that, he also has a farm. He's an entrepreneur. He's there to promote the minority, the visible minority, and he has been putting time for that to promote, to push. For some of you, I can see people are coming, looking at the room going, so where are these Canadians? Just to let you know, in the greater Toronto area, 51% are the people that were not born here in Canada. So I'm just going to mention to Africans that are here and to the people from the diaspora, African diaspora, we need to link up. It's a time that we work with everybody to look at for business in Africa. So we don't need to start looking at who are those Canadians. Those Canadians are these people that are in the room here. All the people that are in the room here, these are business people that have been invited. And these are the people that Senator Oliver has been promoting, has been pushing, and this is where we are. Senator Oliver is just coming today just to tell you how busy he is. He's just coming from Barbados, where he had another major conference there, and he just landed. So if you see him falling here, which means the jet lag is working there. So if you can join me to welcoming Senator Honorable Dan Oliver to come to introduce our keynote speaker. Senator.
Your Excellencies, distinguished guests, there is an old Kenya proverb that says, having a good discussion is like having riches. Today we are all honored to have a good discussion led by a man whose wisdom will help enrich us. Africa is lucky to have a friend like Ned Goodman. He's a financial giant and a visionary. He can see opportunities that many of us routinely miss. He has made transformative and enduring contributions to Canada's minerals industry and capital markets. He has been a company builder, merchant banker, and investment advisor in an incredible career spanning some 50 years. Whatever he begins, he tends to add real value to it. He's perhaps best known to many here as the father of the Dundee Group of Financial Resource and Real Estate Investments that he founded in 1991. And he grew that from a base of $300 million, and he grew it into a $50 billion mutual fund entity, $50 billion. Ned Goodman says Africa is now open for business, and Ed Goodman has gone to Africa, to many different countries. One of those countries is Chad, and he is there with a Canadian company called United Hydrocarbons, and the Dundee Group has already invested more than $300 million in that one venture in Africa. But as a visionary, his investments were not just in things like gold and real estate. He has invested in Blue Goose Capital Corp that produces organic beef, chicken, and fish. His creativity and inquisitiveness knows no bounds. He is a voracious reader, but let me conclude with this. Ned Goodman has received countless awards for his unselfish contributions to Canada and our various Canadian institutions. He is the Chancellor of Brock University and an adjunct professor at others. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in extending a very warm welcome to this Renaissance man, Mr. Goodman, we look forward to your leading us in an interesting discussion.
Thank you, Don, and thank you all for being here. And let me give a little extra thanks to Barrick, who didn't realize that Dundee had already sponsored me, and they sponsored me again. So thank you for the double sponsor. I want to start, being that I'm the entertainment of today based on previous speakers, I want to start with a response to Yosef Oye Daragogo, who made a little fun about my ability to speak French in his opening remarks this morning. He is the special advisor to the president of the African Development Bank Group. And I can tell him, and I tell you, that having been brought up in the province de Québec, au Canada, I can now name you mon nouveau ami meilleur, my newest best friend. But I want you to know, and you should know, that when you're trying to get billions of dollars to put in the ground, you better speak English. You are my best friend now, so don't forget that. I feel honored to have been chosen as the keynote speaker for this very special event that will bring Canada and Africa closer together. I was not told exactly what I meant to speak about, but I found it easy to assume that I should be about Africa and the option for investment by Canadians therein. I was asked to comment as to how I felt about the investment outlook on an overall basis, and I'll try to accomplish what I think is germane to today's event, as well as the outlook for investment overall, and try to use more than my 50 years of experience in being a professional investor with a special outlook to those certain investment properties that benefit in an inflationary environment, which I think we're in, or we're going to be in. In my instance, this has been mostly in real estate and resources, and they have both served me very well. I can only assume that I was asked to be at this podium because of my geological background and the known fact that I've been mainly involved in resources, and that is what Africa is usually related to by many other investors. However, I have to tell you that my studies of Africa has brought me to look even more seriously at Africa as a wonderful source of agriculture. Africa is overloaded with fertile agricultural land and investment land product that none other than Warren Buffett says is very important to investors as a hard, inflation-protected asset. He says it's better than gold. His basis for arriving at that conclusion is that gold, while being money, eventually gets spent and used up, while agricultural land, even after many years, can remain in position and still be used. It never loses its value. And that's why in our investment portfolios, you will find some gold, you'll find some other commodities, and you'll find some real estate to counter old-fashioned inflation. But today, we are also owners of agricultural land in Colorado, British Columbia, and Ontario, but not yet in Africa. We will be. Africa has millions of acres of very fertile farmland and a wonderful climate for growth, and the unique ability to feed the planet, to be the breadbasket of the world. And that's why major food corporations are today grabbing up African farmland to grow food for the world. Like, you got to get out of their way because they'll step all over you. I'm supposed to press a button and get a slide, but I get me. There we go. I saved this cover of The Economist from December 11th to the 17th of the year 2010. You can see that the issue was filled with stories that put the world into three slices of the apple. Slices of where to invest in the world economies as a growing division. So they top-picked the United States. which since 2009 has been in a recession that the Federal Reserve lies about and says that the country is growing. The only thing in the US that is growing is their debt, and to a lesser degree, an overvalued stock market. Second choice was Europe, an area that for the last 5 years has had to continue lowering their interest rates to stay alive. Even just recently, Mario, we will do whatever we can, en français he says that, Draghi has even lowered interest rates to a negative level. There's no growth in the Euro countries. Some of the countries like Spain and Italy are actually struggling just to stay alive. But let's get back to the third choice, which even today is not the most favored pick by the Wall Street so-called money gurus. The Economist and many others in the investment community, and let's not forget this is a 2010 cover, it's 4 years later. The Economist and many others in the investment community have forgotten the most prolific emerging market, Africa. Africa should have been choice number one in 2010 and even today. Africa is a continent that is emerging all over. And there are around 55 countries on the continent of Africa. McKinsey and Company call Africa the last big emerging market in the world. And that's why we at Dundee are comfortable of being investors in African ventures. Very comfortable. I'm going to put this away somewhere it's bothering me. As an aside to my previous comments, let me tell you that every human being today is a descendant of a small group of modern humans who left what is Africa around 60,000 years ago to explore the planet Earth, which, while it was quite old at that time, was not yet populated at all other than the continent of Africa. Homo sapiens, that's what they called us, were confined to tropical Africa and a small part of Southwest Africa. These were people with the same physical and mental abilities as ourselves today, 60,000 years ago. They were hunter-gatherers who were capable of adapting to any environment on the planet Earth, which underwent vastly changing temperatures from sub-zero to fields of steaming tropical rain forests. It is suspected that during the last very cold period of the last ice age, the most significant of all human migrations out of Africa began. Towards the end of the ice age, 15,000 years ago, this vast population movement was complete. We humans, still known as Homo sapiens, have drifted, and that's not French, have drifted or paddled to other places in the world and colonized the planet Earth, where they face drought and food shortages and extreme cold. And about 500 million of us were scattered in small groups over limiting territories. Science is only just beginning to comprehend the process of this historic colonization. But one thing seems certain. All non-Africans, as you think you are descended from what American biologist Stephen Jay Gould called a single African twig on the human family tree. All people alive today have their ultimate roots in the so-called African Eve, or as some called her, Lucy, of some 150,000 years ago. Today, we all share descendant genetic information with the so-called Eve, with each other and with our ancestors. It took until the end of the Ice Age, about 12,000 years ago, for human society to become more elaborate with population growth and new areas colonized. So for today, at least for this special event, let's all agree that we are descendants of Africa, and we are all Africans. Thank you. I have been asked by Nola Kianza to some degree to speak about Africa, but also to provide some words about the business, financial, and investment world, as well as my views about the stock markets. I had thought my invitation to be here as a speaker was related to the fact that I'm a geologist and reasonably heavily involved in the resource industry in Africa as an investor. Dundee has chosen that place of the apple called emerging markets, and we call it Africa. And we're involved in investments in Sierra Leone, Burkina Faso, Chad, Morocco, Congo, Ghana, Namibia, Guinea, South Africa, and through Barrick, of course, Tanzania. And we're standing prepared to look seriously at other ventures. But what is not generally well known is that we are also very involved in the agricultural business in Canada, but not at all in Africa so far. And as an investor, I have to tell you that I'm more excited about what is happening in Africa, in agriculture, than what is going on in the resource world. Agricultural markets are straining to keep up with a demand, and prices have been spiraling upwards, while demand for global food production and biofuel expansion requires at least something just less than 5% per annum growth in order to meet global demand. All the while, acreage expansion potential outside of Africa appears very limited. Much of the wealth creation that we have seen over the last 30 years has been the results of an unprecedented debt splurge, which is impossible to recreate today unless we endure massive and painful debt liquidation that only has been set on stage for the next up-leveraging cycle. The main question that I would ask all of Europe today and the US is, has the world hit the debt wall yet? Because we will someday. So I would like to start about my financial comments and quote from a dear friend of mine, John Ng, who just wrote this in his monthly newsletter, because John thinks the way I do, and a lot of us do. We've all done well over the year with that thinking. To quote him, he said, "Were Mr. Obama to be judged by his golf games rather than legislature changes, he would be a roaring success. Obama played golf 200 times and held at least 400 fundraisers for the next election. Yet, John said, the president's audacity of hope has been replaced by economic stagnation, credit bubbles, and a very big return to a Cold War," is what John called it, "but it's not a Cold War. And investors do not seem to care, having put their faith in Mr. Bernanke and today Janet Yellen, in the continuation of the Federal Reserve's easy monetary policy for the United States. Yes, the market records daily highs, while daily crises registered are not noticed because of the false sense of complacency." And I wrote this last week. I don't think it's doing that anymore. "The U.S. is mired in too much debt because President Obama has allowed the U.S. expenditure to surpass more than all presidents before him, while diminishing the authority and credibility of the U.S. financial system. Despite daily new stock market highs, economic and geopolitical conditions have gotten considerably worse, while the stock market is giving the opposite message." And let's remember that when I showed you that economist, which I can put back on because I don't like looking at myself. Oh, someone got it? There it is. The economist was talking about the United States and Europe. "President Obama hasn't damaged the U.S. currency. The dollar is in disrepute, and according to a recent CNN poll, trust in the U.S. government is now at an all-time low. We're open to many unintended consequences as America is trying to inflate away its massive public debt at a time when debt ratios are more damaging than they were when we saw the U.S. go into recession in 2007. One thing that I've always done, which I learned from my partners Austin Butel and Seymour Schulich a long time ago, I think long term. And the amount of debt outstanding, especially in the U.S. and the euro, is scary. Scary from a long-term perspective. Majority of developing countries in the world are in a transition to modern lives, lives that resemble the U.S. and Canada, France, Germany, Australia. These are changes that the world started about 100 years ago, after 100,000 years of very minor progress. We were able to have a world with around 1.4 billion people, and now we have a greater than 7 billion people and are growing. Growing such that we could soon have at least 10 to 15 billion people all expecting to live like we do in Canada and the United States. This coming period is going to rise, and we need a lot of, quote, stuff that comes from the ground being either a resource or a vegetable or an animal that eats the grass. Those of us that can provide that stuff will have an advantage, and we will have to work a lot harder to deliver food for the world. Today, you have to think differently when you're in the investment business like I am in order to survive. Nearly everywhere you turn, you see geopolitical unrest exploding off the charts, threatening to destroy the portfolios of almost all investors, catching the majority of them on the wrong side of the markets. Just consider, for example, this is what we're up against while we think about the stock market. First of all, let me start with the most recent. The Pope himself has declared that the world is in World War III, and it's a religious war, and it's terrible. But just to take through the list, look what happened with Israel and Gaza, the Malaysian Airlines flight, Vladimir Putin bullying his way through Eastern Europe and now even attempting to reopen a Russian base in Cuba. Especially today, ISIS. The president did not look great when he talked about ISIS and talked about taking them out, but he wasn't going to send anybody there. ISIS, the Islamic State of Iraq and Syria, known for its harsh Wahhabist interpretation of Islam, and brutal violence directed at Shia Muslims and Christians and Jews in particular, terrorizing the Middle East, killing thousands. Talked about Ukraine. Syria civil war, 170,000 now dead. Africa has Boko Haram murdering and kidnapping hundreds of innocent people and children, crusading to create still another Islamic State. Even us, even worse for us Africans, as we all are, all of Africa, where there are now fully many countries engaged in wars of some kind, involving 146 different militia, guerrilla, separatists, and anarchic groups. Asia's got the same kind of problems. And Europe has the same kind of problems. The Middle East, where we have 8 countries involved in 169 different rebel and separatist groups, are now engaged in conflicts. And of course, ISIS just takes it all away. And the Americas. Latin Americas. There are 5 countries either at war or experiencing massive domestic unrest. And these are just the official wars. They do not include the other hotspots around the world that are almost certain to lead to either civil or international war. China versus Japan, China versus Indonesia, Vietnam, the Philippines, Malaysia, and Brunei. These are the countries that are surrounding the South China Seas and the Spratly and Senkaku Islands, which are filled with natural gas. And China has bought mega natural gas from Russia, but they want their own and they want the South China Sea. Europe, nearly all of it, where recent elections have been substantial, have seen substantial gains for parties ranging from the populist to the neo-Nazi groups, and France, where the street is filled with Islamic ruffians. And France's right-wing Marine Le Pen Front National Group topped the nationwide poll for the first time in its history. And where a backlash in many struggling Eurozone nations, decimated by unemployment and austerity measures, catapulted parties like Greece's neo-Nazi Golden Dawn to the forefront, actually winning enough votes to send a representative to Brussels for the first time. As I've also stated before, you may think all these conflicts are unrelated or as a result of religious extremists or they have no impact on you. But mark my words and look closely, as I have done, at all of the above conflicts, whether they are religiously inspired or not, and you will see 2 common threads. Private sector groups rising up against authoritarian, unjust, and corrupt governments. Yes, we do have them in this world. And then private sector groups rising up against governments that want to increase taxes or even confiscate wealth, while at the same time levying austerity measures on its people to slash previously promised benefits, but now have too much debt. In lesser developed countries, it's the result of government corruption, imperialistic actions taken by developed countries, pillaging of natural assets. All the while today, most investment professionals are recommending that we should invest in emerging markets. That emerging markets on that apple should say Africa. Africa is a continent, as I said, 55 emerging countries, some of which have already achieved reasonable development. But most investors do not even know that. I'm more excited about Africa being the breadbasket of the world because of their climate and fertile soil, which means that they have fertile agricultural acres that exist nowhere else in the world. Agricultural markets today are straining to keep up with demand, and food prices are going up. That's why we're in the business. Global food production needs to grow at least at 3 to 5% per year just to keep pace with the dietary needs of the world's population, and biofuels by themselves add another maybe 80 basis points to the demand for growth for agricultural products over the next 5 to 8 years. Acreage expansion appears limited, other than for Africa, limited to feed the world. All emerging markets like Africa, with a greater proportion of land and labor dedicated to agriculture, Africa will be winners in this coming environment. 60,000 years ago, remember that, the planet Earth came into existence. The only Homo sapiens were on the planet were in Africa. After many thousands of years, this new African population moved around the planet, establishing families and increased population for the entire world. As a result, whether you're male or female, Islamic, Jewish, Christian, or any other faith you can think of, or whether you have pink skin, blue skin, white skin, yellow skin, red skin, or whatever, from a global basis, we are all Africans. We are descendants of African people of 60,000 years ago. Well, one more. Let's look at the US, the Euro, and the emerging markets. Africa is that continent with 55 countries, which are all emerging markets. Today, the US is in deep trouble, too much debt, and overall financial trouble ahead. Europe is even worse, in bigger economic trouble. Africa is the home of emerging markets, with 55 different countries to choose from. All are emerging economically and financially, and are becoming even well-managed as we go forward. In order to not get bogged down with precise descriptions, let me describe Africa as a big country. 55 countries, 900 million people, which is full of deserts, jungles, highlands, savannas, and lots of unused arable and fertile agricultural land, waiting for the world to catch on that Africa is more than resources. The continent of Africa today is at a crossroads. They have a vision of social, economic, and civic empowerment for the historically marginalized, which is what they used to be. That's why they understand it. We at Dundee have chosen to be in the African emerging markets, and we are involved in investments in Africa in the following countries: Sierra Leone, Ghana, Burkina Faso, even though I don't speak French well. Chad, even though I don't speak French well. Congo, Namibia, Tanzania, of course through Barrick, Niger, Guinea, Morocco, Namibia, and South Africa. In the last 10 years, Africa has added 15 cities with a population of over 1 million people. And this is expected to increase by 19 by the year 2020, for a total of 71 cities with more than 1 million people. In the last 10 years, 117 million Africans migrated to cities, and Africa has 52 cities with a population in excess of 1 million people who live with an urbanization level above that of India, quickly catching up to China on a relative urbanization basis. Africa is rated 40 to India's 30, China's 45, Europe's 73, and North America's 82. The obvious question that comes to mind: can Africa's fertile farmland feed the planet? if the people on the planet ever stop fighting at wars, with or without the terrible warring that's going on in World War III, a terrible religious war is happening right in front of our eyes. We do know that no matter how many get killed in this foolish war, the day will come that the world will have about 2 billion more newly arrived people, and agriculture in the African continent is easily the most important asset the world will need during the next 30 years or more. I'll end with one little story that tells you where I stand, because I can go on for hours here. I often agree with George Soros for several reasons. He's very smart. He's actually older than me and still smart. And he's betting against the stock market. For institutional investors like George Soros, keeping secrets for long is an impossible task. The United States Securities and Exchange Commission requires these entities to file a 13F, a form called 13F, which is a quarterly filing required of investment managers of assets of $100 million or more, which contains information regarding the asset manager's investment style and potentially even a list of equities owned. All that's available for you if you can get it on the internet. And George Soros has done that. He has labeled himself very bearish as of September 2nd of this year, 2 weeks ago. So an investor like George Soros suddenly increases a bearish position by 605% in a quarter, it raises more than a few eyebrows and it gets my attention. For the quarter ended June 30th, Soros Fund Management reported a large investment in puts. Puts means you have the right to sell your stock to someone else no matter what. And options that give the investor that right but not the obligation to sell that security. For an ETF that tracks the Standard & Poor's 500. Let me break down Soros's current position. His total short position leaped from 2.96% to almost 17%. Making the largest part of his holdings for the second quarter. It doesn't sound like a hedge, it sounds like a bearish speculation. If we closely examine the stocks he did add to, it's clear he's preparing for a worst case scenario. Soros doubled down on gold mining ETFs and added plenty of gold-based companies to his portfolio. He increased his position in Market Vector's Gold Miners ETF to 2 million shares, worth around $54 million from 1.2 million shares in the first quarter. He also established a call option investment worth 1.3 million shares of Gold Miners ETF. The gold addition is telling. Gold is an asset class that we typically buy as a hedge against inflation or economic uncertainty. Real interest rates are in danger of becoming negative with the inflation rate at 2% and the yield on the 10-year treasury at around 2.33%. This means that inflation-adjusted rate of return is a scant 0.33%. The general consensus is that gold prices will actually fall in the next 12 months. Goldman Sachs estimates that gold will fall to $1,050 an ounce, a drop of nearly 20%. Speculators have pared back stakes in gold futures by 15% for the week ending August 5 as well. So if Soros isn't adding gold to his portfolio as a bullish sentiment, then the only reason left is a hedge against the bear market. But one firm, albeit a well-known one, establishing hedges and speculating in market declines isn't enough for us to question the strength of the five-year bull market that has appeared because of the United States. Following in Soros' footsteps over his career would have been smart. He is perhaps more famous for his trademark trade made in 1992 when he shorted the British pound for a net gain of $2 billion and forced the Bank of England to devalue the currency of England. When he takes steps to leverage himself to profit from a downfall, investors should take notice. The Eurozone is in depression. On September 9th, European Bank lowered interest rates on its main refinancing operation by 10 basis points to 0.5%. In addition, the interest rate on its marginal lending facility was reduced by 10 basis points to 0.30%. And interest rates on its deposit facility was reduced and even more. And the rate of deposit facility was reduced to minus 0.20. So the economies of Europe are not doing well, and the European Central Bank cannot be the savior of the Eurozone like everyone would like, despite the hard work and off-the-wall changes by Mr. Draghi. Europe is not likely to become competitive to deserve any kind of place on that apple, even as of 10 years ago. The economy is in tatters and not very much in the way of recovery. I can go on and on about it. The dollar value is eroding in the US, and the US will probably lose its reserve currency status at some point soon. The Chinese do not like that 64% of their foreign reserves are in US dollars, and the dollar is being devalued. If we look back 100 years, US dollars buys you 4% of what it did when Henry Ford was running Model 7s. That means the Chinese are sitting on a mountain of money that keeps depreciating. For China, that's $40 billion per year. The sheer amount of money that the US Fed has created was unprecedented. The United States is in trouble. We are in World War III. We don't know how that's going to end. It's not going to end well. And I'll come back to it. Africa may be the salvation for us as investors to be, because as bad as it might be in some of the places in Africa, it's not as bad as it being in Europe, the Middle East, and the United States. So I say we must prepare for the return of inflation. And I'll get to the end here in a second so we can call this a day. I think I'm going to get to the end. It says stop here. We're on the cusp of a secular change, a world that is dominated by China, India, Asia, and especially those emerging market countries like Africa. A world which will see new middle-class population groups the size of the United States emerge several-fold over the next 20 years. As Africa and other emerging countries continue their emerging state, the deflationary price advantage from their low-wage environment, which should begin to disappear at the same time that employee benefits are surfacing and going higher. Altogether, to quote Jim Grant, the world seems to be running out of uninflated cost structures. So, where do I find myself? I find myself concerned about the stock market. And I'm going to end a lot of these bearish remarks before I get to hyperinflation. I haven't got there yet. And death of the US dollar in total, and scare everybody out of the room. But it's a possibility that we are going to have some hard times. I'm looking for my last page and I can't even find it, but that's okay. Let me talk a little bit about Africa. Look at Africa as a continent on the move, even though it's often hard to notice. The Western focus on governance and foreign aid can often put shadows out there on individual success. But the recent developments are good. As well as being on the move, Africa provides an unexpected view when one looks harder. The bright continent, as it is called, is looking brighter. I'm not saying that after 50 years in the investment business, I'm absolutely positive about the negativity that I just gave you. But I am saying that the pundits that disagree with me might have flawed thinking and are basing their extreme bullishness that you hear about the United States on a daily basis on incorrect metrics and with a lot of hope. My years of experience are telling me to be careful, but with more importance, to wait for the correct time. Always being at the right time is very important. And so this is the right time. It's almost 2 o'clock. Thank you very much.